Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Little Women. Thanks for coming out this Saturday night. I'm Chad Anderson, director of the show and musical theater director here at NOC. And this is a really fun show. I've enjoyed thoroughly working with these very talented ladies and a few guys in the show too. But I really hope that you enjoyed. I want to thank Santa's Forest in Ponca City for giving us, donating a really special prop that I hope makes it for the next 24 hours. We have one more show tomorrow. So thank you to Santa's Forest in Ponca City. Go see them next Christmas. Coming up in this space, March 25th, Redbud Jazz Festival. You don't want to miss that. That's always really great music. Our students plus some visitors come in and jam for a while with Eddie up here on the stage, and you're going to enjoy that. April 2nd, Rastabout Benefits Show. Always blows the roof off this place, so you want to come see that. And that's the same day as our departmental audition, so if you know any seniors who are thinking about coming to NOC, they want to maybe do some of this stuff right here, or roustabouts, or band, or jazz band, come talk to us, and we would love to talk to you about coming to NOC. Instead of our spring play this semester, we're going to do something a little bit different, and I'm really excited about it. It's the first annual 24-hour play festival here at NOC, and what happens is people sign up ahead of time, actors, writers, and directors. They all meet April 15th, that's a Friday night, in this space, split up into teams consisting of two actors, one writer, and one director. And then that night, the writer goes home and writes a short play, about a 10-minute play. And the next morning, the director and the actors begin rehearsing. And they perform it that night, that Saturday night, April 16th. So it's literally a 24-hour rehearsal production process. And so it's going to be about 8 or 10 short plays, consisting maybe an hour and a half or lasting an hour and a half, and it's going to be a good time. If you know anyone that would like to sign up for that, to be a writer, an actor, or a director, or a techie, can't do it without the techies, then that link is going to be in our Performing Arts Facebook page this Monday. So go give that Performing Arts Facebook page a like and follow our events. Also, be sure and come visit us in the lobby at intermission, our concession stand. The money raised there goes to help send our kids to New York. As you know, we try to go to New York every year. We just didn't last year, but we're going to get to this year. And it's partly in thanks to you. So thanks ahead of time for your purchases, your donations there. We really appreciate it. Going to turn things over to the maestro, Dr. Eddie Dixon. Thanks for coming to Little Women. Enjoy the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Kinzer Performing Arts Center. At this time, we ask that you silence and refrain from using all electronic communication devices. Also, for the safety of our performers and due to copyright regulations, no photography or video recording is permitted. Thank you and enjoy the performance.
Miss March.
Mrs. Kerr, the mutton you ordered is on the kitchen table. Thank you, Professor. Christopher Clonis, another publisher. Another rejection?
I do not know. I do not read your letters, but they keep arriving and I keep bringing them to you.
And I keep hoping.
We all keep hoping for your success, Miss March. The entire boarding house keeps hoping. You have us all on edge.
My dear Miss March, I've read your story. Well, he's read it. Unfortunately, I found your tale tasteless and vulgar, not at all suitable for my readers. My advice to you is to...
My advice to you is to return home and have babies. This is what women are made for. Sincerely, F. Puff.
22 rejections since I've been to New York. They all say the same thing. Go home, give up.
F. Putnam is an idiot. His words are stupid.
F. Putnam is one of the most powerful publishers in the city.
You cannot lose faith, Miss March. There will be someone who will like your story. I am certain of it.
Professor Bayer, is it possible I could read my story for you? I would so respect your opinion.
Yes, of course.
Actually, it's one of my best. It's a mean and stormy night. The moors are bleak and bloody. Thunder claps! Lightning strikes! The fair Clarissa, her clothes in disarray, races across the wild coastal heath. Now she stops. Now she runs. Will she escape? Will she be caught? With bold determination, the villainous aristocrat grasps her Prendergast, lurches for her. There's no escape. She's but a child. And yet she turns to fight with eyes ablaze. This noble girl meets his gaze unafraid. She will not be defiled.
Keep away from me, you wretch!
I cannot keep away. Your beauty draws me. Your passion ignites me. I've got to hold you.
I defy you.
But you have me.
Let me buy you.
Come close.
Not come too close.
Come close.
Don't come too close.
So close, so close to me. I'll have her. And the mother too.
Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
I've had that privilege.
Seduction on every page.
Read history. Read Shakespeare. Read the newspapers.
I think it is best we pursue this some other time.
No. I want to know what you think, Professor.
Blood and gut stuff. What you think the world wants to hear. If I have noticed nothing else about you, Miss March, I have noticed you are unique. Something you should try not to forget. I think you could do better.
Better? And who are you anyways? Some aging German professor? Close to 50?
I am 34.
34? Really? Well, you look a lot older.
I worry a lot.
And just what do you worry about?
How to avoid a conversation such as this. Now I will go to dinner. Miss March, since you have been here 6 weeks now, is it? You shout, you rant, you upset the whole order of this boarding house. I am a serene and peaceful man.
You're aloof. You're arrogant.
Arrogant? Miss March, I spoke my mind as you spoke yours. Obviously, it was not appreciated on either side.
Obviously. My stories were a great success in Concord.
Thank you.
my nose is flat.
Joe, I hate being a governess. I should be out meeting eligible young men.
Christmas is going to be dismal this year. What with Father gone and no money for presents?
Meg, Amy, Joe has a surprise for us.
This year and written us an operatic tragedy.
And we're going to perform it for Christmas.
I can't. Not with my flat nose.
Joe, do you really think we should with this awful war going on? When have we let anything defeat us? Years from now, people will talk about us. One Christmas Eve, four penniless and ragged sisters put on an operatic tragedy for all of Concord.
Joe of Concord.
Filled with blood and guts. Two massacres, a mass ball, and several heart-wrenching scenes. We'll dim the lights, the crowd will hush. We'll start the overture and Beth will surely blush. And when Clarissa starts to plead, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams.
Joe, do I die again in this one?
Yes. Maggie will die like none before. The world will shudder when your body hits the floor. For when Rodrigo makes you bleed, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams. Now Amy as Clarissa, only passion is permissible. This tragedy depends upon the fire in your eyes. And Beth, when you're the mother, you'll be noble, you'll be pure. Somebody, give me a
task to do.
I want you to bring Father home.
I shall write President Lincoln tonight.
Another, I want you to get Annie Moffat to invite me to her St. Valentine's Day ball.
I'll wring her bloody little neck if she doesn't. Another,
I want you to bring us a Christmas tree.
Rodrigo shall chop one down immediately.
Where?
There, across the road.
But that's Mr. Lawrence's property.
You'll go to prison for it.
Prison? What care I for prison?
Joe's an amazing human being.
Look, it's Mr. Lawrence. He's standing in the window, glaring out. He looks sinister.
I think he looks sad.
I wouldn't be sad living in such a house.
Do you think anyone's ever been inside?
He'd never let any of us in. They say he's a very angry and bitter man. Joe is going to get us all into deathly trouble.
We're
going to
be known as the family with the criminal sister.
What criminal sister?
Mari!
What's happening here?
Joe has written an operatic tragedy.
And she's inviting all of Concord to come watch us perform it.
And I'm the mother in it.
And I die in it. But it's a beautiful death.
And I play Clarissa, who's very sweet.
It sounds wonderful.
Oh, Marmy, it's Joe's best.
Tell us about your day, Marmy.
Well, we knitted socks and blankets for the Soldiers' Aid Society. And a letter came from Father.
A letter from Father?
Read it to us, Marmy.
Where's Joe?
She's outside.
Read the letter, Marmy.
We'll wait for Joe.
She may be ours.
I want to hear all the things you did today.
Marmy has returned!
Joe!
Marmy!
Where did you get that tree?
I borrowed it from Mr. Lawrence.
Joe, you didn't.
I took it for us, Marmy.
You'll take it back immediately.
Take it back? That's like taking back a chicken after you've chopped off its head.
Do let us keep it, Marmy.
It's Christmas.
No. Destroying someone else's property?
We could give it to the Hummels. They have so little.
Good. The tree goes to the Hummels then. Now what about Mr. Lawrence?
What about him?
Mr. Lawrence?
Yes, Mr. Lawrence. You.
Me?
You chopped down my perfect Virginia pie. I should have you arrested.
I'll make it up to you, sir.
With what?
I'll plant 6 more.
12.
And I'll chop your firewood for a few days.
Weeks. And I should hope such an incident should never happen again. You've ruined my day.
He sure loves his trees. I'm Theodore Lawrence III. But everyone calls me Lori. I come to live here in Concord. I play the piccolo, and I can sleep standing up, and I once won a medal at school for holding my breath for nearly 3 minutes before passing out. I think it was terrifically daring of you to cut down Grandfather's tree. Well, goodbye.
Theodore Lawrence III, would you mind delivering this tree to the Hummels?
Joe!
I wouldn't mind at all.
He doesn't mind.
Just put me in a direction.
They live half a mile down the road. The red house with the broken shingles.
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Joe, you must think before you act on every whim.
I just want us all to have a wonderful Christmas.
A letter's come from Father.
Christopher Columbus!
Do read the letter, Marmy.
My dear wife, the war goes on. The end seems nowhere in sight. The days are difficult and long, but I am well.
He's well.
Still, it's very lonely away from my dear ones, especially lonely as Christmas is approaching. Each night in my tent, I think of my precious girls.
He thinks of us.
Give them all my love and give them a sweet kiss. Tell them to be good girls, faithful and hardworking, and to conquer that which is disagreeable in them. So that when I return, I'll be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women.
Why are we looking
seem so glum? Do we have an operatic tragedy to perform or not?
We do.
Then there's work to be done. Curtains to paint, costumes to finish. I'll need to get an oleo curtain for you to paint.
Will you perform something, Marmee?
Do, Marmee.
I'll write something thrilling for you with passion and daring.
Yes, yes I will. This will be the best Christmas ever. We March women are invincible. Now come, let's get to work.
I'll grab my paints.
I'll look for a costume for Marmee.
I'll design the handbill. I still don't know why we couldn't have kept the tree.
Reading to me, touch on my cellar door.
I got delayed finding you this beautiful flower.
Don't trifle with me, Josephine. You were dawdling.
I wasn't dawdling. I was writing a story.
You are what happens to a girl when she has no father.
I have a father.
Never here when you need him. And now my nephew has the audacity to be an armory chaplain when he can't even support for his own family. Josephine, listen to me. You were on the verge of womanhood.
Christopher Columbus.
And just look at you. You go about writing these senseless stories, constantly trying to save the world, and yet you can't even save yourself.
I don't mean saving.
There are many pitfalls a girl can fall into, and Josephine, you are heading towards all of them. I want to see you shine. You may not be rich, but you can at least marry well.
I'll never marry.
You'll marry? All girls marry.
I'm not all girls.
With a good marriage, you can have power. You can take your place in society.
I don't give two figs about society.
There is no point in having this conversation. It's clear to me that I could never take you to Europe.
Take me to Europe?
It was an idle thought of mine.
Do you know how important it is for a writer to travel? It's been my dream, Aunt March.
We earn our dreams in this world, Josephine. It's foolish of me to think you could ever change your ways.
I could try.
You can never bend your will. You can never follow through. You can never bite your tongue, though your tongue may split in two. If you want to live your dreams, these are things you have to do. How could you change? You can't. Not you.
I could change if I wanted to.
Could you practice self-control? Could you possibly shy? Could you wear a corset tight in the heat of mid-July? These are rules you must obey, everyone which you defy. You'll never change. You won't. That's why. Yet somewhere deep within my heart, I do believe you could captivate the world. If you could change, there is so much you could.
Oh,
it'll be you, Beth.
Me? You really think so?
Meg?
I can't go.
Meg, why not?
Look at me. Every girl in Concord my age has been to a ball, and I haven't even worn a dress like this. Anything like this.
I wore that very same gown to my first ball, and I didn't look half so good in it. Margaret March, you've been dreaming of Annie Moffat's St. Valentine's Day ball for months. You can't just walk away from it now.
I'm not built for gowns.
You look alluring.
I think the word is alarming, Marty. Meg's the beauty. Look at her. She'll be the most sought-after girl at the ball.
She doesn't want to go.
Meg? What will I do when someone asks me to dance?
Just smile and say, I'd be delighted.
Delighted.
Then offer him your hand. Delighted.
Delighted.
Now let him take command.
I'm hardly delighted.
You're dancing like a candle.
No, I cannot dance tonight. I'd be delighted that you go.
The music is entrancing.
Exotic,
hypnotic. The sound meant romancing.
Delighted,
delighted.
And some of them are glancing. People everywhere.
Elegance to spare.
How can I make sure they'll like me when I'm there?
I can see you dancing all night. Lovely girls.
Thank you.
accident.
Joe.
I swear, Meg, Mrs. Parrot kept creeping in on me like a mountain lion. And she had this gigantic ear trumpet, and she kept shouting at me. What's that you say, my dear?
She's deaf.
Well, she got so close to me, I ended up spilling my entire glass of punch on her.
Joe.
And then Annie Moffat said to me, can I be of help, Sally? Sally? Who's Sally?
I think it's her dog.
I ought to box her ears.
Joe, don't. We'll wait a few minutes, and then we'll go back in as if nothing happened. Our heads held high.
Yes, you're right. For a young lady who's soon to travel abroad and do amazing things, I shall return poised and elegant, brimming with confidence. I shall sit grandly. Oh, Christopher Columbus!
Excuse me.
You?
Me?
What are you doing here?
I passed out. Too much dancing, I guess.
Too much punch, I'd say.
Laurie? Laurie! Laurie, where have you been? I have been looking everywhere for you.
Mr. Brooke, I want you
Your grandfather will be furious. He wants you to meet some very important people.
I have. These are the March girls I've been telling you about, from across the way. This one's Meg, right?
Yes.
And that's Joe. She cuts our firewood on occasion. This is Mr. John Brooke, a scholar from Boston.
I am Laurie's tutor. Come, Laurie.
Excuse me, sir, but you've taken my dance card.
Your dance card? Oh, is this yours? I'm so sorry. So, you're Margaret March?
Yes, I am.
It's a splendid party, isn't it?
It is quite lovely. So, you're from Boston?
Maine, actually.
I've never been to Maine.
You should go. It's beautiful country. Very pretty.
I like primitive.
Really?
Mr. John Brooke's a romantic.
Is that true?
Well, no, no. I read Sheets and Kelly. Keats and Shelley.
So do I.
You read Keats and Shelley?
All the time.
Christopher Columbus.
Would you like to dance, Miss March?
Meg, we were just about to join the ladies in the salon.
I'd be delighted, Mr. Brooke.
Excuse us, Joe. Did you see that? He just... What is it with you and that smile?
You make me beam.
Well, you look ridiculous.
Well, you're looking very fetching tonight.
Fetching? Really?
So, tell me, when you're not attending balls, what do you do?
I write bloody gut stories. I make extraordinary plans. I'm going to Europe. I'm going to meet famous writers and revolutionaries. What about you? What do you do? Marmy said you're all alone in this world. No mother or father. That must be awful for you.
It's not awful. I have a cranky old grandfather, and I have a cat, and I have...
What?
Well, I was hoping to say... you.
Me? You don't have me.
I know I have no right. But sometimes late at night, I watch you in the attic, pacing back and forth like a maniac. I've never met a girl like you, anyone at all like you. This is very nice, it's such a lovely party, the music sounds so thrilling. It makes a person feel like dancing. I'm very good, I won a medal for dancing at school.
I don't dance. Besides, I've got a patch on the back of my dress.
A patch? Let me see.
No! No!
I like it! That patch could start a whole new fashion. Dance with me tonight, and I guarantee by next spring, every girl in Concord will be wearing a patch on her dress. We could do 100 things, do anything you please. We could fly on golden wings across the seven seas. I'll bet you'll get a camel through a needle if you take a chance on me.
You're a lunatic.
We could catch 1,000 stars and set them on a pin. We could leap from here to Mars and make the planets spin. If you want to do all the things you've ever dreamed of, come on, take
box?
Ready?
I ought to warn you, I won a medal for boxing at school.
Dancing and the ankle seems to be sprained. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
The evening began very strangely, but ended magnificently. Good night.
Good night. Can you walk on it?
It's nothing, Marmy. Tell us about the ball. I tried to do all these ladylike things, Marmy. It all went unnoticed. Except by Mr. Lawrence's grandson. And poor Meg. No one even asked her to dance but that pompous Mr. Brooke.
He danced divinely. I had a wonderful time. Actually, it was the best time of my life. I may have left here a girl, but I came home a woman.
A woman? What's she talking about? Meg!
It's just Meg being silly, Marmy.
Come, girls, off to bed now. It's been a long day for us all.
Beth, darling, look what I brought for you. A truffle!
Thank you, Joe.
Amy!
Good night, Marmy.
I'm sorry for the things I said, Joe. And for you, Miss March, a pediform. A little squash, but still edible. I just want to put the finishing touches to my story, Marmy.
Don't be too long, and see to it that the fire's out.
My sister Bird.
You could have given me the invitation.
The invitation was meant for
Amy. My time will never come! I'm always forgotten! I'm always last and never invited anywhere! I have nothing special—
That's enough, Amy. Both of you look at me. I cannot demand that you two love one another, but I can demand you live together with respect.
I hate the way I look! I hate this nightgown!
It was mine.
I want something that's mine! I'll take that thing.
I'm so sorry.
It's not your fault, though you did give birth to her.
Can't you see she wants to be like you? She wants to have what you have. She's just a child, Joe.
She's not just a child. She's a demon in a child's body.
Joe, if I could bring your story back, I would.
My writing is everything to me, Marmee. It's who I am. It's my passion. It's my future.
The passion and the future, that's still there. Believe me, Joe, it's still inside of you.
I'll never forgive her.
You're not wrong, Joe, to feel anger. But if you build a wall between you and Amy, the one person you may end up hurting is yourself. And I couldn't bear it. Try and get some sleep.
I can't sleep. I won't. I will never fall asleep again. Not for decades, no, not even then. My life was in that story. How could she be so cruel? How can so much be easily. I wrote my heart out, it does not seem fair. I'll rage until I'm withered, I'll grow cold and bitter. Carlotta, the mad woman in the attic, a creature of God. I like this, a spinster rejected by the world. Yes, she changed her appearance. She attached golden braids to her hair.
Winter's over.
All right, I'll give you a 2-minute head start.
2 minutes?
And still beat you.
Go with them. Joe doesn't want me. Go anyway. She hasn't talked to me in 3 weeks. I tried to draw her this picture with her long, beautiful hair, and she just ignored it. Besides, my skates don't fit me anymore anyway.
Take mine.
Can I really? Thank you, Beth. I hope I can be sweet like you one day.
You are sweet.
Watch where you're going.
Sorry, Mr. Lawrence.
That piano sounds terrible.
It needs a tuning, sir.
Where is my grandson, Lori?
I'm sure he'll be back soon.
The boy has missed 6 lessons, fallen behind in all of his work. I've strictly forbidden him from associating with his family.
Well, why, sir?
Because a man needs an iron will if he is to succeed in this world, and his family will only soften him. Which one of the dreadful little March girls are you?
I'm dreadful, Beth.
Oh, yes.
Lori said you're the one who wants to play my priceless piano. It's out of the question. The piano belonged to my daughter, Lori's mother. It's been locked and she passed away, and that's how it shall stay. Are you afraid of me?
A little.
Why?
It might have something to do with your face, sir. It's very hard.
I cannot help my hard face. Continue what you were playing. Come now, I have it all day. Well, are you going to play or not?
If you say, come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go. We will buy dishes there, maybe even two sets. Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while on crepe Suzette.
Well, go on.
We will build model boats off in Massachusetts, there in Massachusetts, by the bay. Put them together and we turn to the closet.
Well, what's the matter now?
I don't remember the rest, sir.
While we wait, we'll polka for the folk along the parapets.
Off
to Massachusetts.
Yes, we're off
to where the shops are sweet.
We will play minuets off in Massachusetts, Boston, Massachusetts, Beacon Street.
If you say come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go. We will buy dishes there, maybe even two sets. Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while on crepe Suzette's.
Massachusetts, yes, we're off.
Yes, we're off to where the shops are sweet.
We will have no regrets off in Massachusetts.
Boston, Massachusetts, we.
Boston, Massachusetts, we.
Boston, Massachusetts, we repeat. Well, goodbye.
Goodbye, sir.
Come visit me tomorrow. We'll see if we can find the key to that old piano and see if there's any music left in it. Will you come?
Yes.
And when you see my grandson, Lori, tell him I must speak with him immediately.
Meg!
What is it, Beth?
Mr. Lawrence was here, and he invited me to come over and play his piano.
Oh, Beth?
He's really not as horrible as we imagined.
Amy?
Joe, what's happened?
She fell through the ice.
She was skating by the bridge and the ice gave way. I got to her just in time.
She's careless. She's rash.
She just wanted to be with you. Here.
I was skating so beautifully.
You don't think. You know you're not supposed to skate by the bridge. Everyone knows the ice by the bridge is dangerous.
But you didn't want me skating near you. I'm sorry for what I did, Joe. I tried to write another story to make up for what I did, but I couldn't think of anything. So I drew you that picture with your beautiful hair.
And my big mouth.
You just ignored it.
You skate recklessly. If it hadn't been for Lori, you could have been killed.
Maybe it would have been better if I had.
You must never talk like that. When the ice broke underneath you, all I could think was, I could have lost you.
Then go on, Joe. Forgive her.
See how much she's changed.
See her sweet side.
Everybody stop it. When you burnt my story, I was devastated. I didn't understand how you could do such a thing. But promise me, promise you'll never think of me as an enemy, but a sister who loves you.
I promise, Joe.
The March sisters forever.
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 Amy, and made this day possible. I want to declare before everyone, before the world, that on this day of joy and forgiveness, that you, Theodore Lawrence III, who has valiantly lost all contests to me, I declare you our brother. the brother we never had. Swear to us your greatest oath of loyalty, an oath as dazzling as your charms.
I swear I'll follow you like royalty.
Come where our royal code demands. From now on we are joined, and we shall not be parted. From this day on it's all for one, and one forever like.
We'll live like musketeers.
Together we'll prevail. We'll be fine forever from now on.
Now each of us must swear for all eternity, our bond shall never be undone.
Nothing shall sever this fraternity. We'll always live and die as one. From now on we are joined, and we shall not be parted.
From this day on, no matter what,
we're fine for all our life.
Together we will fight.
Your battles will be mine.
We'll be fine for all forever from now on.
Speech.
Good morning, Beth.
Good morning, sir. I fixed you a basket of food.
Thank you, Beth.
Amy's almost ready. She's packing up half the house.
Where's Joe? I sent her to Aunt March's hours ago. She should be back by now.
I'll go look for her.
Thank you.
Here's Father's shawl he loved so much. Marnie, please don't make me go live with Aunt March. Her house is so old. Everything in it is just scary. I drew you this picture with apple blossoms in your hair. It's for Father. Is he gonna die?
No.
I'll see to it that he recovers. Now go, get the rest of your things.
Mommy! Mommy, I'm sorry I'm so late. I did get the money, though.
Thank you, Jo. I know how difficult it was for you to ask Aunt March.
I didn't ask her. I couldn't. So instead, I went down to the town commons, and I stood there all morning trying to sell one of my stories. And when that failed, I sold my hair.
Oh, my.
Jo, you're bald.
I'm not bald.
Your hair was your best feature.
I think she looks beautiful.
Now Marmy will have enough money to get to Washington and stay with Father as long as he needs her. Here, $25.27. I threw in a few coins I had stashed away.
Jo, you shouldn't have done this. I'm so...
disappointed?
Proud. That was a very courageous thing to do. Thank you, Jo.
carriage is ready, Miss March. Joe, you look different.
Miss March, you must hurry if you're going to make it to the station.
I guarantee by next summer, every girl in Concord will be wearing her hair.
Lori,
come, let me hold my girls.
We've never been parted before. I feel awful, Amy.
Don't worry, Marmee. I'll take care of everything.
My dear Margaret, make certain your husband recovers.
Yes, Aunt March. Thank you for taking Amy. Amy, tell Aunt March how excited you are.
I'm so excited about living with you while Marmee's in Washington.
Naturally.
No glum faces and no tears. I'll be back as soon as possible. How did you all grow up so fast? Goodbye, Aunt March.
And you'll tell Father how much I miss him and I love him?
Josephine! What have you done?
I sold my hair so Marmee could have a safe journey to Washington.
You did what? I've told you, if you need money, come to me.
I was hoping to earn my own money.
Selling one's hair like a beggar is not an option for a lady. You look like a shorn sheep. Have you forgotten our contract?
I never forget it. Traveling, seeing Europe, Paris, London.
You don't live up to your part of the bargain. Why should I live up to mine?
I've tried to live up to my part of the bargain. I went to a ball, I've practiced my manners, I read books on etiquette, I practiced dancing with men, I held my tongue in several situations when I wanted to cry out. I've got a fire in me, Aunt March.
Well, see where this fire takes you in life. See what doors this fire will open for you. See what society thinks of your fire.
To hell with society.
Josephine.
We don't live for society. We live for what we have inside of us. We live to expand our minds, fulfill our dreams, engage in passionate exchanges.
You act like you know everything, and yet you know nothing. And as for Europe, you can forget it. Europe is meant for someone who is more understanding of its rewards.
Aunt March, please.
The subject is closed.
The subject is not closed, and if it is, I open it up again. I'll go to Europe. I will. I'll go to Europe if I have to swim there. Hello, John.
I like your haircut, Joe.
And my hair will grow back.
And who is this man?
He's Lori's friend and tutor.
Tell your friend this visit should be brief. Amy, collect your things. I'll be in the carriage. I have plans for you.
Yes, ma'am. John.
Meg, I have news. I've enlisted. I couldn't stand around any longer. Your own father is in the Army Hospital in Washington. I have friends who will never return.
When do you leave?
Tonight. Meg. Margaret. I am not a rich man, nor am I particularly handsome.
You're very handsome, John.
Really? You think so? I am not the wisest man in the world.
You're very wise.
Thank you, Meg. Margaret.
If you could forget in your heart, if you could love me as I love you, if only you cared we are apart, wise, I would be more.
will write to you every day, twice a day, five times a day.
It's settled!
What?
We'll all go to Europe. Why shouldn't we go? Here we are, young women, on our own, taking care of ourselves. It's time we looked ahead. We'll save our pennies. I'll get a real job.
Joe.
I've worked our itinerary. We'll go to Spain first, Madrid, then to Rome, visit the Vatican, have an audience with the Pope. It's a wonderful idea, isn't it?
Joe, John proposed, and I accepted. Meg? Meg, that's so romantic! Meg's engaged! Have a big wedding! Aunt March says they're very fashionable.
Amy, Aunt March is waiting for you. I'll come visit later.
Goodbye, everyone.
What about our promise to remain together?
That was a long time ago, Joe. I've changed. You've changed.
I haven't changed. I'd never make a promise one day, then break it another. Our word is everything, Meg.
I love him.
So you love him. I'm talking about us. We're all alone now. Our future as a family is at stake.
Joe.
You can't turn your back on us.
I'm not turning my back on you.
I told you I'm going to be a famous writer.
I know.
I'll give you everything you've ever dreamed of.
But if she loves him, Joe.
And I do. With all my heart and soul.
I've lost Meg.
You haven't lost Meg.
I've lost my trip to Europe.
You'll find your way there someday.
I know you will.
You can do anything, Joe. You can make the clouds disappear.
It's you who makes the clouds disappear.
Come, walk with me and tell me about your adventures today.
Well, I sold my hair.
Yes.
And before that, I stood in the town commons, and when no one paid attention to me, I cried out, "Joe March is here!" And then I recited my story, Carlotta, the mad woman in the attic.
Creature of gold, a spinster rejected by the world, hungry for blood, rose from the dark. Joe! Joe March! Her eyes a beady red, her hair a ghastly white. Joe! Your best friend, Theodore Lawrence III! With fingers clutched with rage, went out into the wretched night.
Laurie, Christopher Columbus! You've not been here in weeks.
I've been in Boston. I have terrible news.
What news?
Well, with the war ended, grandfather's insisted that I get on with my life. He's enrolled me in school.
What?
I'll be off to college before the summer session.
That's wonderful news.
What's wonderful about it? Leaving the best friend I've ever had?
I can't imagine life in Concord without you. Not seeing your silly grin every day.
I don't want to go.
But you've got to go. This is an incredible opportunity. College, I'd go in a minute. I'd study everything.
What do you need with schools? You're going to be a famous writer.
Famous?
I have to tell you something.
Tell me something.
Ever since the first day I saw you, do you remember that day?
Of course.
The day you cut down grandfather's cherished tree. Since then, I knew that you and I would be magnificent together.
We are magnificent together.
My sweet Joe, for weeks now, months even, this whole year actually, I wanted to...
What was that?
A kiss.
I know it was a kiss.
It was my first kiss, actually. I thought about it a while. Practicing saying the words over and over again. Marry me. Marry me.
Have you gone mad?
I love you, Joe, and I want you to be my wife.
No. No. Find someone else. Find some accomplished girl.
But I don't want an accomplished girl. I want you.
Well, you can't have me.
At least say you'll think about it.
There's nothing to think about. I'll never marry.
You don't mean that.
I do mean it.
You'll marry?
I won't.
You will. Just not me. That's what you're really saying. You'll find someone.
Go away, Lori. I thought you understood me.
You knew all along how I felt. Everybody knew.
You knew all along who I am, what I want. I bared my soul to you, Lori. Go away.
Joe.
Please, just go. Who's he? Who's he with marry me? With his ring and to marry me, the nerve, the gall. This is not what was meant to be. How can he ruin it all with those two words? I thought I knew him, thought that he knew me. When did he change? What did I miss? A kiss, when I thought all along that we were meant to forge my tears. How could I be so wrong? And I need, how I need my sisters here. If I can't share my dreams, what were they for? I thought our promise meant that we would never change and never part. I thought together we'd amaze the world. How can I think my dreams are even start when everything has come apart? I thought home was all I'd ever want. My attic, all I'd ever need. Now nothing feels the way it was before, and I don't know how to proceed. I only know I'm meant for something more. I've got to know if I can be astonishing.
This one's the theme, yes? Okay.